when we know that the resiliency research says this clearly, that one emotional connection with a teacher, with a coach, with an educator, someone that typically is not a counselor, is not a social worker, you know, might be a school counselor or a school social worker, but one emotional connection can change the brain architecture of that child's disposition, of that serve and return. It can repair that process. And because of this, because of neuroplasticity, that's what this is right here, in our brains, we have over 100 billion neurons. And when I say that between the ages of 10 and 14 is the second greatest time of brain change, that's when everything that we do and what we practice, we keep. What fires together, wires together. So we have an electrical chemical reaction, and we teach the students this. We have two brain cells, and we have information connecting in that aha moment between each one. The dendrites of one brain cell receive the information from the axon of the other. We're teaching the students this. They love this. And that's when they make a change in a behavior, a change in a thought. And here is what I want to share with you as teachers. How many students do you have diagnosed with ADD right now? Raise your hand if you have a child or if you know of someone that has a diagnosis of ADD. And here is, this is just incredible research. Listen to this. Right now, we are looking at trauma-informed education. We know that PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, the symptoms of that are almost identical to ADD symptoms. And here's the other thing, and this is amazing to me. Emotional ADD is not just about inattention and impulsiveness and hyperactivity. It's about this frontal lobe. It's about emotional regulation being stagnated. All behavior, negative behavior, is about this ability to not control or emotionally regulate, if you think about it. And so when we look at the number one strategy I want to share with you tonight before I leave, and I'm like throwing up on you right now because I only have like a couple of minutes left. We have to teach our students about their own neuroanatomy. That we're doing this in Washington Township schools across the district. We're doing it in Lawrence Township starting next year in Pike. And we are teaching our students about the amygdala, the prefrontal cortex, the little seahorse structure, the hippocampus, which we haven't even talked about yet tonight. And then we're talking to them about, this is amazing, the 90-second rule. Dr. Jill Bolte Taylor has shared that our body rinses itself clean and clear of negative emotions in 90 seconds. So why the hell do you stay mad for days and weeks and years? You all hold resentments. I hold them. We stay angry. Your students stay angry. I mean, we stay so angry and negative. Why is that? What do? We tell ourselves, don't we think about it over and over again? And don't we share it? Oh, you won't believe what happened to me. You won't believe what she did to me. You can't believe what happened at our family Christmas. And we're teaching students this. The more you share it, the more distorted this story becomes. And this is research-based. This is our memory, and we're teaching students that too. It's not even a true story anymore. Every time you share it, it becomes more distorted. So I brought, and I'm gonna give these out to you. So go ahead and stand up. You've been sitting too long. And I wanna share with you, Dr. Joseph Ledoux has this, he's like my favorite researcher from New York University, and his specialty is the amygdala. And I'm gonna leave you with strategies, but this is new. These are brains, by the way, and I'll give these to you. But they're eraser tops, like, you know, for pencils. And I have all kind, I have gummies in here, but I didn't have enough to give everybody. But this is what I want to share with you. This is fascinating. Listen to this. From your amygdala to your prefrontal cortex is like a 470, 465 or 70. It's a super highway. So here's what happens. You're driving along and somebody speeds past you and nicks your car. I mean, literally, takes the side mirror right off. Your reaction is immediate. You are angry in a tenth of a second. A student is sitting at their desk and another kid walks over and just slaps him across the head or shoves his pencil off the desk and he is ready to fight. That is because in our neurobiology, and we're teaching the students this, there's that super highway between the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex, but coming from the prefrontal cortex back to the amygdala is a farm gravel road. It's a dirt road. So we can't tell ourselves to cool it. We cannot, okay, this is so great. Look at this. One of my students, I can't do this tonight because I'm in a dress, but I'll show, this is what happens. Someone ticks you off, you get triggered, and so it's just, so watch how fast. So someone makes a comment, and that's it. I mean, I'm on the floor. I had that super highway, I am so angry. Now, so you saw how fast that happened. Now, I'm gonna put these back. Do you see how long it takes to get back to your prefrontal cortex? And so one of my graduate students, Walt, he did this. We gave a presentation at Northview Middle School on Tuesday morning, and he brought this big pillow and he had a chair, and he just fell onto the floor into his pillow, and that was this. And then he said, look at me getting back onto my chair. So what I want to share with you tonight, go ahead and you can sit down. So what I want to share with you tonight is that we're teaching students about their neuroanatomy, we're telling them about the 90-second rule, and we're helping them to calm the brain and prime the brain. And I'm going to give you the number one strategy. I have so many, but here's what we're doing. We are teaching them focused attention practices. We are teaching them to quiet their minds. We can't say meditation in Indiana. We can say it in Boston at the Educational Neuroscience Conference, but really, if you know the true definition of brain training, when we quiet the mind, we literally initiate an oxygenated blood flow in the prefrontal cortex, a glucose blood oxygenated flow in this prefrontal cortex. That's where we hold sustained attention. So we are having them focus on a stimulus, an Altoid mint, a sound, a color, a visualization, and we are teaching them how to quiet their minds. And it's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. The teachers build up to twice a day, or if you're teaching secondary during your period, 90 seconds when they come in, or whatever you need when they leave. But we're teaching them about their neuroanatomy first, and then we're teaching them focused attention practices. I have a lot of information on that, so please feel free to reach out and connect with me. This is one of the research-based strategies, and I have to share this with you. At Crooked Creek Elementary, when we put these into practice consistently, I hate the word fidelity too. So when we put these practices in, we did a pre, mid, and post test with the two fifth grade classes that I was in during that time period of the semester. For the very first time in those two classes, we had 100% passing on math I-STEP in those two classes. Now, it wasn't a pure study. We couldn't get rid of all the variables, but we knew that there was a shift, there was a change. I wanna leave, do I have one more minute? Okay. So I want to leave you with another strategy that's one of my favorites. They're called dual thought sheets. And So in how many of you have a student fill out a thought sheet or a reflection sheet when they're, you know, when they've made poor choices? So one of the things, and I think that's fine, is, but if they're in their limbic system, if they're in that fight or flight, it's not going to work. And sometimes as teachers, we feel almost panicky to give out consequences right away. So one of the things that we created is a dual thought sheet or reflection sheet. And here's what happens. If you look at the very front of this handout, when a child doesn't know how to swim, we teach them, right? And if a child doesn't know how to do an algebra problem, we teach them. If a child doesn't know how to read, we teach them. But if a child doesn't know how to behave, what do? We punish. And really, if we're true to the pedagogy that modeling is best practice, we need to be teaching the behaviors we want to see. And so these dual reflection sheets, every time an incident happens, and I walk this walk, I did this. Every time I had a conflict with a student, I filled out a small sheet with alongside them. I know that I could do it better. I know I could do it better. I get into that conflict cycle so fast. I saw myself do it. So I've got 4 or 5 questions, and I can send those to you. I've got a template, and I didn't give that to Mark, but if you would like that template, I'll send it because it's really simple. I put it on LinkedIn, and it's like, what are our challenges? So that's number one. What was the challenge? Or number two, what could we have done in a different way? What's one adjustment you will make? What's one adjustment I will make? And here's what happens. It just levels the playing field. It levels the playing field. Because here's the truth about our brains. We are feeling creatures who think. It's not the other way around. We are feeling creatures who think. And if we are 70% there when we have emotionally connected with that student. And we know today, with the demographics that we have in many, many of our districts, we have students coming in holding 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 of those adverse childhood experiences. Those indicators are pretty significant. We know that. So the educational neuroscience looks at storytelling. The brain loves stories. The brain, it looks at academics. How do we build engagement academically? It looks at emotional regulation and behavior engagement. And then we look at relationships and how to prime the brain for relational learning. How do we prime the brain for content? And how do we prime the brain for the behavior we want to see? So I'm gonna close tonight with a story. And I want you to think about, what do our adolescents, when we think about that critical time between ages 9 and 15, I'm going to spread it out. What are they looking for? Remember your adolescence? Do you remember how important peers were? Do you remember how important social connection was? And do you remember how novelty and that risk-taking were a part of it? And we used to think that it was all hormones. It's not. This part of the brain looks like a piece of Swiss cheese with holes in it until 25, 26, 27, 28, 29 years old. When you can't rent a car in the United States till you're how old? 25. They get it. I mean, they do. And men, the development is later. So our adolescents, I'm sorry. So our adolescents are looking for that novelty and that social connectedness. But I want to share the number one thing that we all are looking for. And whether you're an adolescent or you're a first, second, third, fourth, or fifth year teacher. So I'm going to close with this story tonight. It's my favorite. And you can actually share this story with your students. You have to modify the words, but we're using it as an engagement tool in the classroom. So I'll read it to you. It's very short. There is a tribe in Africa where the birth date of a child is counted not from when they were born, nor from when they are conceived, but from the day that the child was a thought in its mother's mind. And when a woman decides that she will have a child, She goes off and sits under a tree by herself, and she listens until she can hear the song of the child who wants to come. And after she's heard the song of this child, she comes back to the man who will be the child's father and teaches it to him. And then when they make love to physically conceive the child, some of that time they sing the song of the child as a way to invite it. And then when the mother is pregnant, the mother teaches that child's song to the midwives and the old women of the village, so that when the child is born, the old women and the people around her sing the child's song to welcome it. And then as the child grows up, the other villagers are taught the child's song. If the child falls or hurts its knee, someone picks it up and sings its song to it. Or perhaps the child does something wonderful or goes through the rites of puberty. Then as a way of honoring this person, the people of the village sing his or her song. In the African tribe, there is one other occasion upon which the villagers sing to the child. If at any time during his or her life, the person commits a crime or aberrant social act, the individual is called to the center of the village and the people in the community form a circle around them. Then they sing their song to them. The tribe recognizes that the correction for antisocial behavior is not punishment. It is love and the remembrance of identity. When you recognize your own song, you have no desire or need to do anything that would hurt another. And it goes this way through their life. In marriage, the songs are sung together. And finally, when this child is lying in bed ready to die, all the villagers know his or her song, and they sing for the last time the song to that person.